My name is Dennis Pierce. I'm the National President of the Brotherhood of Locomotive Engineers and Trainmen. We are a division of the Teamsters Rail Conference. Along with me here tonight is Jeremy Ferguson, President of Smart TD. Our goal here tonight is to share with you what is in the tentative agreement that's currently out for a vote. We're not here to tell anyone how to vote, and we've taken criticism for that, but we're going to stand by that. Our goal is to make sure you have the information you need to know how to cast your vote as you see fit, and to know what your options are based on how you do that. As background, BLET and Smart TD both started this round bargaining together for the second time in the history of our unions as part of the Coordinated Bargaining Coalition. Later on, BMWED and Smart Mechanical joined our group, and for the first time in the history of modern history of Railway Labor Act bargaining, all of the unions at the bargaining table joined together to form the United Rail Unions when we went to the Presidential Emergency Board.
So, I want to talk a little bit about the history, how we got here. I took office as the new president on October 1st of 2019. I wasn't in the chair more than probably about 32 hours when the carriers served notice, carriers, that's plural, served notice on us that they were coming after our crew consist agreement, wanting to take the conductors off the trains. That would play a big role and where these national negotiations were headed. I had our District 1 General Chairman convened that day here in Cleveland, and part of that day's meetings was to compile and start gathering all the Section 6 notices, what we wanted included, how would we proceed with national negotiations. So that was a rather interesting day, to say the least. Shortly thereafter, we started getting the coalition together. Obviously, both of our unions filed our Section 6 notices timely. The carriers filed theirs. And we started off to the races. Now, soon after in 2020, we held our first face-to-face meeting with the NCCC, trying to see where things were going to go. The carriers were adamant that this crew consist battle would, of course, affect all unions involved in national handling, because the carriers were not going to budge, they were not going to budge until our union gave in on crew consist and allowed the conductors to be removed from through freight trains. So not only was our union directly affected, but every union in national handling was going to be directly affected by the carrier's moves there. So we had our hands full. Shortly after the first meeting was when COVID began to set in, and then, of course, that took away our ability to have face-to-face negotiations. We ended up trying to do some video discussions. Carriers continued on their path of not only crew consist, but they upped the ante a bit and made sure that if we didn't cave in, we didn't give in to their ways, that all Smart TD, or BLET conductors for that matter, operating on through freight trains, would be facing a pay cut. Not entitled to any of the wage increases, be looking at increases in healthcare costs above and beyond what everybody else was. So we had our hands full. I'm sure you're all aware of where we went with the court battles, and then into arbitration, two arbitrations, and whatnot that was separate and apart from national negotiations. Now, this is before the carriers even put any kind of proposed wage increases on the table. We didn't even know what kind of money was out there for the entire group, the entire coalition. But I'm sure Dennis will cover that in a little bit here, but, We had some tough decisions to make, trying to keep all the unions in the coalition working forward, and I felt bad because of what was going on with our crew consist. But what made me proud was to know that we had solidarity amongst every union in our coalition, including the BLET. We were standing together strong and tall, and we weren't going to back down on all of our issues. So, Dennis?
Well, going to the bargaining, as Jeremy said, we did some Zoom bargaining. We got back to in-person bargaining in 2021. For the first 2 years of these negotiations, the railroads refused to even put a wage proposal on the table. That's how frustrating this was. As Jeremy said, they were trying to drag this thing out, delay it, trying to get some union to cut and run and do a settlement that could then possibly be referred to at a presidential emergency board. That is a pattern of behavior for the rail carriers. They were unsuccessful. Our group did stick together. Interestingly enough, at one of the meetings, the railroads actually proposed to the BLET that if we were going to defend the conductor, we ought to take a cut in pay if we wanted to have a conductor on the train with us. This is how desperate they were to break crew consist. Having been at the table for 2 years without a wage proposal, that was when we put a 36% in 5 years wage proposal across the table. So when people talk about where we were, where they were, those were the original goalposts. They were at zero, we were at 36. They made their first wage proposal to us in January of 2022, and it came in at 11%. Think about that. That's inflation was starting to climb. That's after you guys worked without a pay wage, a pay increase for the better part of 2.5 years. As part of that wage proposal, as Jeremy said, they required that no conductor would get any raise unless Smart TD capitulated on crew consist. This was completely unacceptable to all the unions in our coalition, and to their credit, they all stood together and said it was completely unacceptable. Having gone back and forth with them in the interim, there were obviously work rules on the table that we'll be discussing that they were pushing at the same time. But the bottom line, guys, is if we cannot get you a voluntary deal that you would accept, under the Railway Labor Act, it takes us to the government in some form or fashion. And that's what happened when we filed for mediation in January, shortly after they made these insane proposals.
So, first step under the Railway Labor Act, once you reach an impasse, is to file for mediation. And I can remember that day very clearly. We were in San Diego, and we quickly reached an impasse in negotiations. The carriers were adamant that we had to give in on drastic changes to health care, in addition to the crew consist. What they wanted for work rule changes was not acceptable to us, and the list went on and on. We as a coalition decided we were at an impasse, and that afternoon we went and made our filings with the National Mediation Board. So the mediators got involved. That really didn't seem to resolve any of the issues. We stuck with that for another 3 to 4 months. And as the NMB realized that we were going nowhere, anything that was pushed back and forth across the table was unacceptable to either side. So the proffer of arbitration was made. And we immediately turned down that proffer of arbitration. The carriers did accept, but that there started a 30-day cooling off period. At the very end of that cooling off period was the next step of the Railway Labor Act, if the government chose, or we would be looking at self-help. But President Biden stepped in and issued a presidential emergency board. So that was soon formed. Now, I want to talk a little bit about what a PEB is and how things work there, because there seems to be a lot of misunderstanding about how we have this tentative agreement in front of us by some. When you go to a PEB, you do not negotiate. This is basically the final step in the Railway Labor Act. You go to a PEB and you litigate. You bring a lot of attorneys, you bring your health and welfare consultants, you bring your economists, and you have a lot of attorneys there, I should say. But you argue for what you want, and the other side gets to argue for what they want. And then you go back and forth. You argue why they shouldn't get what they're wanting, what they're requesting, and we do the same. So what we've seen come out in that PEB recommendation was that panel of three, that jury or the judges, however you want to look at them, that was their decision. That was the recommendation made to the President of the United States. not to us unions, but to the President of the United States. So as that recommendation comes out, we have to take that document or that those recommendations, and we have to make them into some form of a legal binding agreement under the Railway Labor Act if we are going to put that forth to the membership for ratification. So we, of course, Dennis and I and the rest of our coalition, which ended up being all the rail unions involved, quickly went to work on that. Now, as we progressed from that recommendation, we had issues in there that we didn't like. If you look at certain things that we won, we were very happy with. You look at some of the other issues, yeah, that was a disappointment. But that was nothing that we negotiated for in that presidential emergency board. Would you like to?
Yeah, I'll jump in. Going back to the proffer of arbitration, it's important that everybody understand the difference, because there have been some third-party outsiders who have speculated that if you don't ratify this agreement, your union might impose binding arbitration on you. We rejected that offer when it was made last summer. And there's a difference. I think it's critical to understand the difference between binding arbitration and a PEB recommendation. If you go to binding arbitration, our union did that in 1985. Arbitration Award 458, it's called. Nobody liked it. An arbitrator writes your agreement and you're done. There is no self-help. There's no former or additional cooling off. You're just done. We rejected that, and we rejected it internally as well as back to the NMB and the rail carriers. When you go to a PEB, they make a non-binding recommendation. There's a difference between the two, and that it's then incumbent upon the parties to meet and see if they can turn that into an agreement. We'll get into a little deeper of the history of these PEBs at the national freight level and how they've been handled in the past, but the common move is to go see if you can turn that recommendation into an agreement. When we returned to negotiations, as Jeremy said, several of the other unions in our coalition were able to reach an agreement, and they didn't have a lot of the same issues that you do. They didn't work on an unscheduled service. They weren't on a rotating call board. Most of them worked in shift work 5 days a week. They too have overtime issues. They have forced additional shift issues because of PSR-style management, but their issues were not identical to ours. Anyway, we returned to the table to see if we could accomplish that. In the end, we were down to just a few unions that had not reached a tentative agreement. Smart TD, BLET, and the Signalman were the last three that I think waited the longest and stayed at the table the longest, trying to see what kind of a deal we could get. We also knew from our polling after the recommendation came out that it was very unlikely the membership would accept the pure recommendation converted into an agreement. And that's why we decided not to vote that. And that's a clear distinction that we need you guys to understand. Our goal when we went back to the table was to improve on those recommendations, and our commitment to you is we would not vote it unless we did. And that's what we set out to do when we went back to the table. Worth noting also, guys, in the last few days, that got more attention than any of the other parts of this drawn-out process. Our unions, while we were at the bargaining table, we had lobbyists on the Hill because of the possibility of congressional intervention. Between the Teamsters, our new general president, Sean O'Brien, sent about 100 lobbyists to the Hill while we were bargaining. Smart TD, Maintenance Away, BLET, all had lobbyists on the Hill talking to congressmen, talking to senators to find out what Congress might do if they chose to intervene, because that is something they can do. And I'm proud to say that interaction gave us the space that we needed to be able to come away with improvements. While we were at the table, most of you are familiar with the fact that Senator Burr, North Carolina, went on the floor and sought unanimous consent to try to impose the peer recommendations with no enhancements. We knew you wouldn't accept that. That's why it wasn't voted. Bernie Sanders, we all owe him a debt of gratitude, went on the floor and blocked that. Unanimous consent is an attempt to just pass something without a vote. It takes one person to block it, and Bernie Sanders was that one person. We knew at that time that we had time to bargain. But guys, with all that group on the Hill, it was also fairly obvious that Congress was very, very reluctant to let you walk off the job in September. When people think that we had the leverage You have to put the interest of 115,000 railroad employees against the interest of 350 million Americans that Congress is looking out for. And the impact, I think in some circles, guys, the idiotic things that the railroad said at the PEB about you not contributing to profits, they said it. It's true they said it, but it's not true. In the end, you guys are too important. What you do is too important to the economy of this country. And that is my personal opinion as to why Congress was not going to let us walk off the job. And that's why it was our job to see if we could make improvements to put it out for your consideration. With that, I'm going to jump into some of the early wins and losses. As Jeremy said, there are things that we were disappointed in, things we're very pleased in. Smart TD won on crew consist, guys. I don't think anybody should overlook that or underestimate the value. The railroads tried to do what they did in 1991 and get a PEB to impose a binding solution on UTU then, Smart TD now, to force the issue of conductors being on the job to arbitration within 6 months. They thought they would succeed. If anybody is telling you the railroads love the PEB recommendation, they're wrong, they do not. They thought they would prevail on crew consist and engineers would be out there alone in 6 months. So when you look at the wins and losses, never underestimate that one, because everybody in this room has conductor seniority, and it's critical that Smart TD prevailed on that issue. The two big issues that we both jointly made, we made a proposal to the PEB that all attendance policies should be immediately voided and replaced with negotiated policies. We did not prevail. The PEB did not recommend our proposal, they rejected it. But here's what's important to note. We also made a proposal that on railroads where there are no assigned days off, that the general committees of both of our unions have the right to serve notice on the railroads, compel them to bargain on days off, and we're talking rotating pool boards and extra boards, where there are no rest days to reach assigned days off for all those employees on a voluntary basis. We did prevail in that regard. I'm going to put a slide up here to show you what that really could mean. There are several ways to accomplish assigned days off. Some of the Norfolk Southern engineers and CSX engineers here tonight, these have already been accomplished for the engineers on a lot of these properties. On BNSF and UP, it's not near as common, UP hardly there at all. What we're trying to do, guys, here, and I think this is, although it didn't eliminate attendance, it certainly takes the teeth out of these policies, especially on the Western roads. In the example up here with 6 and 2, that's an 8-day cycle, there's 45 of those a year. That means that in an annual cycle, knowing when your days off could be, you can have access to 91 days off in a year's time, and here's why that's critical. Today on BNSF or UP, you get points if you take those days off. All of these days are available without points if this is the model that's adopted. 6 and 2, guys, 91.25 days off in a year. And again, if you're BNSF, so you understand the policy over there, you take a weekday, it's 2 points out of your roughly 28 points you've got. If you take a weekend, it's 4 points. Because none of these cycles are an identical 7-day cycle, they all work you into weekends and weekdays. And those days that you would take unpaid today and get points for and get fired for, you get this many that you would never be given points for. We've actually had people tell us, why do you think I need that much time off? This is probably 25% of the year, guys, compared to guys who work 7 days a week, in a lot of cases get their RSIA days off reset in a hotel and are getting no access to time off. So again, while the policy doesn't go away, it certainly has less teeth in it when you get access to time off. One of the other models is A7 and 3. This was very commonplace on BNSF for a number of years on a voluntary basis. You could take 1, 2, or 3 of the days off, so long as they were consecutive. 7 and 2, 80 days off. 7 and 3, 109 days off, guys. That's well over a quarter of the year that you could take off with no points under an attendance policy. So again, I'll keep saying it. The policy doesn't go away, but the teeth come out of it if you can take this amount of time off on your scheduled days off without any penalties. 11 and 4 is also a model. There is a pilot program on Union Pacific right now to try an 11 and 4 model. The part that comes out of this, guys, that's worth noting, our general chairman have been trying to negotiate with the rail carriers for decades to get guys' days off, and we never had the leverage. We never had the leverage to force them to bargain. It was always a pilot, and if they didn't like it, if it cost too much, they canceled it. The difference in Article 5 of this agreement is it allows the general committees to serve notice, compel bargaining, And if they cannot complete an agreement that would be then voted on and accepted locally, they would have the right to take the railroads to arbitration and get those rest days in place. If adopted in 6 months' time, the bulk of the unassigned freight world will have access to time off. This is a fundamental change in the way unassigned through freight service is operated in this country, especially on our western roads. You can't discount the availability to get this level of time off with no points under an attendance policy. I'll throw it back to Jeremy.
Well, you've got Article 5 covered there very well. Reading the PEB recommendation, you'll note that the recommendation took what we argued for, which was a voluntary 5-2 work cycle. Carriers argued for ABS, the automatic bids, and then the self-supporting pools and that additional language, which is ABS is known as Article 6 in the TA, self-supporting pools is Article 7. What the recommendation did was it took those three issues and said, yeah, both parties won on what they argued for with their respective issues, bundled them together, chucked it out in the recommendation and just said, go negotiate. If you can't get anything negotiated within 6 months, then you have mandatory party pay arbitration as a backstop immediately thereafter. What we had to do to make sure we protected you guys is that when we put this into a tentative agreement form, we had to ensure that we put all four corners on the page, put some guardrails up. And the most important thing that you'll see is only those who won their issue can serve the notice, number one. Number two is that you can only serve the notice once, once and done clause. That was huge because anybody that works in interdivisional service under Article 9 of our national agreements, you'll notice that every time the carriers want to change their operating plan, they have a new, you know, great idea of how to run their railroad. They want to change all the interdivisional service agreements. So they can file another notice, then you got to go negotiate and possibly go arbitrate. It's a continuing, evolving problem for all of us that work under interdivisional service. We didn't want to deal with that with their issues. So they get one shot at it. We get one shot at our rest days. The other thing, though, that we had to, you know, ensure is who was going to negotiate it. Was it going to be negotiated at the national level for all the railroads that are under these agreements? Or were we going to put it back to the general committees, to the on-property experts, right? So we had to make sure we spelled that out in each of these articles and clarify that it was not going to be us at the international level trying to negotiate a standard agreement that would apply to everybody across the country. Because each road is different, each general committee agreement's different, and so forth. Everybody's going to have their own little issues that they want to get hammered out. So we wanted to make sure that we got it back to the experts. I don't think anybody wanted us trying to, you know, shove a square peg into the round hole at our level. So those were huge, huge changes and differences from what you see just in the plain recommendation. You know, now, I'm sure you've all read Articles 5, 6, and 7, so you can see, like I said, who can file, you know, who can serve the notice. Doesn't mean you have to serve the notice, though. Doesn't mean this is automatically implemented. So there'll be a second part, if this is ratified, there'll be a second part to negotiations and ratification. Unless you can't get to a tentative agreement, then we're going to keep the process moving, which will end up in arbitration. And that's expedited, party pay arbitration. It's not the standard type like most of us are used to dealing with discipline or time claims where you're waiting for Section 3 funding to get your case heard. This will move much quicker so we can get the rest days in place and get those protections out there so you know, you have some defense against the attendance policies if you're working under a harsh one. So some of the other things that we argue for in the PEB was the 15 paid sick days, right? We had the a number of people that came to us wanted to make sure we could get those in our next agreement. Unfortunately, the PEB did not rule in our favor on that. But, you know, we also asked for 3 additional holidays. We were not successful in that. However, the PEB did, recommend that we get 1 additional day a year to be used either as a PL day or as a daily vacation day or a day off on your birthday. It's 1 additional day. That's what they ruled. So that is what you guys see in your agreement there as Article 4. I guess, Dennis, if you want to cover the wages.
I'll jump into wages. There's been a lot of talk, guys, about how we came to the proposal that all of the rail unions, and that's a key part of this, again, that all the rail unions agreed to present to the board. As I said before, we started at 36 when they were at 0. That's how far apart we were. They came up to 11. Ultimately, by the time we got to the PEB, the proposal made by all the joint rail unions that our economists assured us we could support was a 28% proposal over 5 years. The railroads came in at 16. So this idea that there was somehow too much movement, when you look at what came with the reduction from 36 to 28, there's a few critical pieces that some folks are leaving out. Our proposal would have changed all these wage increases to a January cycle instead of July. Doubled the value in every year. Obviously, your wage number would be the same at the end of the contract, but over the life of the deal, paying them in January doubles the value compared to paying them in July. That was our proposal. That split about half that difference between 36 and 28. One of the other issues we pushed for was an increase in our proposal for sick leave. We had been arguing for 11, we argued for 15. The furniture was moved around in the way we made this proposal. But it was all made in a way, as Jeremy said, you're making a presentation to the Presidential Emergency Board. This isn't the place where you're going and bluff. You have to have economical support to justify your positions, and you can rest assured that the fact that inflation was high in this year was part of the presentation we made. So I think that the position that all of the unions jointly made was the right position to take. And it's why I think the wage proposal that the recommendation came out with is the highest in 50 years. For example, in our last agreement in 2017, there were 12.5% in wage increase money, roughly 2.5 a year for 5 years. This one is 22. That would be a 3% wage increase retroactive in 2020, 3.5% in 21, 7% this year, 4% next year, and 4.5% the year after. Again, the midpoint was 18 when we started. We landed at 22 in the recommendation. In addition to the 22%, it turns into 24 compounded. That means that you apply 1 wage increase upon the last number that resulted from the previous one. For example, if you're on a $100,000 job, it's the easiest example to use. You'd be making $124,000 at the end of 2024 when this agreement is completed. The ratification back pay, if accepted, it would be 14% wage increase on day one. More than likely on or about January 1 of next year by the time we get our votes counted and determine if it's ratified. That's an approximate back pay check for a guy making $100,000 of about $19,000. And that goes up if you make more than that. At the same time, the board, the panel recommended that we get 5 $1,000 lump sum payments for the 5 years of the contract over and above the 22%. 3 of those would have retroactive application. That $19,000 number would include the first 3 payments. Again, the combined retro pay would be roughly $19,000 on $150,000. It's closer to on $100,000. It's closer to $30,000 in back pay, to be paid within 60 days if ratified on $150,000 basis.
Now, let's switch over to healthcare just for a little bit. We were adamant since day one when we started the negotiations that we were not going to give in on any healthcare changes. We were not going to compromise there. We had given up too many pay increases in the many contracts before this to get the great healthcare plan that we do have. And with everything going on, with record profits with the carriers, we were not going to bend this time. And we were successful in that. The good news is there are changes to the healthcare plan, 2 of which are positive for us. One of which is the hearing aids or the hearing coverage. Every year going from $600 per individual to $2,000 a year per individual. That also goes to your dependents. So you need hearing aids, your wife needs hearing aids, you each are entitled to $2,000 a year in that coverage. The other one we were very successful on was the speech therapy and the coverage for autism. I hope you never have to go through any of that. You know, I have friends and family with autistic children, and it is a very difficult hardship for all involved. But when you talk to some of our members that had dependents with autism and the speech therapy issues, it was also a big financial burden for them. So by removing that age gap, some individuals are going to realize an actual increase in their disposable income because it's no longer going to be an out-of-pocket expense. So those were two big wins. Now, the 15% that we've seen come out of the PEB recommendation for our monthly health and welfare contributions, that's not, I don't consider that a plan change, but what that is going back to the same language that we've had for the last four national contracts, is whatever the railroads are paying per month for the national cost for our plan, we would be on the hook for 15% of that. Now that rate is only adjusted once every year, in usually October or November. We just completed our annual setting of the rates. And as you guys can plainly see here, with a new rate setting that we did here last week, effective January 1st of 2023, there's the overall cost, $1,972.43. Then you add in your dental, your vision, your life insurance with your accidental death and dismemberment coverage for the total cost. So at the 15%, we would be on the hook for $309.21, okay? Now, like I said, this rate can only change once a year. If we can go to the second page, going back to our 17 agreement, where we actually froze the 15% at the $228.89, which is what we are currently paying, you can see how that 15% progressed up until the year 2022, which would technically put us at $287.46 if we would have continued on that 15%. Remember, though, the 2017 agreement had a number of changes to the actual plan that required more out-of-pocket costs for us as individuals when we went to the doctor, when we had medical coverage or medical attention, excuse me. But this plan and this agreement is now different on that, thanks to the PEB, that we have no changes to the plan, including, you know, the co-pays, the deductibles, the other out-of-pocket expenses that we would normally realize in different contracts. There is no changes there. So we were fortunate on this one for 2023 also, that you know, we had projected it would be about $319. We came in $10 under that. But you know, when we look at where our plans are at and that monthly cost for what we are getting, you know, that is a good deal for all of us that are under this plan. So we hope in the future, thanks to one of the other recommendations of the PEB that covered rebidding, that we can start to find collectively together with us and the carriers, start to find cost savings without changing any of the benefits, which would, you know, look for different vendors, look for different prescription providers, and help to bring down those costs. There's a number of other issues that are out there that hopefully we can get to work on. We've got some of our health and welfare experts in the room with us here tonight, and we can talk about that later. But there's a number of changes that we're hoping to do to continue to bring those costs down. We have historically seen over the years where that 15% actually lowered. It didn't go up every year. That 6 or 7% increase that we've seen on the internet, that is not guaranteed it's going up that much every year. It does fluctuate, and it has previously fluctuated down for a savings to us for our monthly contributions. So, Dennis?
Okay, one more thing about the healthcare plan, guys. One of the other roles that I play is chairman of the CRLO, which is the other half of the joint policy that we hold with the carriers for your national health care plan. UTU plan is managed by Jeremy and his group. The CRLO manages the benefit for the rest of you. The rate setting Jeremy talked about occurred last week, and here's how this plan works. There's rumors out there that the railroads are going to somehow find a way to raise this cost to raise your 15%. The reason that's a bit of a fallacy is they're always going to pay 85. I'll go out on a limb and say, yeah, they treat you like assholes, and they may not like you, but they're not going to spend their own money to get to yours. It just doesn't work that way. Here's how the plan rate is set. They take all the cost for you and your families to go to the doctor for the year. They add a fixed administrative fee. They divide by the number of actives. It's actually that simple. And that's the number that you see on the screen that then sets that annual number. As Jeremy said, we've been agreeing to pay 15% of that premium for the last four contracts. It started in 2007. But the number goes up because those plan costs go up. With the cap that we had last time at 228, we avoided all those increases of 15% if it had been calculated annually. The difference this time in the PEB recommendation is that the PEB agreed with the railroad's push to reset it every year annually on a one-time basis to where it would not stay static. So that's important to recognize that the recommendation itself would have allowed that annual premium when it goes up to also bring up your 15%, even in years when we're at the bargaining table and there is no contract raised to offset that. The other piece to remember when you compare the increase in this 15%, as Jeremy said, there's no other increase in your cost to go to the doctor. They wanted to raise the premium for those that had children and spouses. They wanted you to pay more when you went. They didn't get that. The only increase you will see is in this monthly contribution, but to the rumor mill that'll eat all of your wage increases, the $1,000 payments over the life of this deal will more than cover the increases that you will see in your monthly premiums. The 22% is free and clear. It will not be affected by this increase in healthcare cost. Going forward, guys, after we got the recommendation, obviously we went back to the table, and we stayed there the longest of any of the unions. We would not vote it unless we got improvements, and the first one I'm going to talk about is on that 15% payment. Strictly per the recommendation, the railroads would have had the right to reset your 15% every year, and you can see what that would have looked like in the last contract had they had that right then. That's why we went back to the table and said we have to put a cap on this. And that is where our unions obtained a side letter that puts a cap on this at the end of this contract. It can't climb over what that cap is while we're at the bargaining table, and if you guys followed this year, this time around it was 3 years. So they cannot increase it. That is an improvement over and above the PEB recommendation. It was not in the panel's recommendation as we received it. The other issue that we tried to improve on, guys, when we went back to the table, attendance policies were a big part of this, as we said earlier. We did not prevail on eliminating them. The worst cases of treatment of our membership across the country had been related to how medical events had been treated under the attendance policies. BNSF actually terminated an employee, and some of his points were because he had a heart attack. They terminated a guy that had to be off for COVID following protocols, gave him points, fired him. We wanted to take a shot at the worst case of those medical issues. Our original proposal was that all medical events be removed from attendance policies, period, paragraph, nationwide. That was the goal when we went to the table. And while we did not get all the way there, we made a dent towards the most important of those issues. We obtained a side letter for people in unassigned service, and this isn't a definition based on the railroad's policies, it's the contractual definition of unassigned service. This piece will apply to anyone working on a rotating pool board, extra board, on-call basis, whether you have assigned days off or not. That group of employees will have access to 3 medical events a year. And this isn't 3 days off. This is the time off you need to attend 3 routine medical events. We're talking physicals, colonoscopies, hearing exams, eye exams, the things that we want our members to do for one reason, take care of yourselves. The other is to lower the plan cost by having preventive care instead of finding something when it's too late. That will even lower the cost to the plan. Those 3 events obviously have qualifications to get to them. But when you look at the qualifications, it doesn't mean you can't take off on Monday to be at a Tuesday event. It just means that the events will be on the days of the week that 90% of the time you're going to have the availability to get into a practitioner and get your visit in anyway. Those 3 medical events are available to everyone in unassigned service with no points to be given under any attendance scheme. That means if you're under an attendance policy today or they're talking about putting one on, they could not give any points or demerits of any kind for you going and getting your medical treatment. In addition to that, all medical events, or all employees who have a hospitalization or a surgical procedure are prevented from having any points assessed to them. That would address the heart attack guy. That would address the guy that lost all his points for having his gallbladder out. Trust me, I had mine out, and nobody would do that on purpose. The idea that medical events get pulled into attendance is an atrocious application of these policies. Our general committees continue to arbitrate these cases, guys, and 90% of them on the Western roads, UP in particular, we are winning those cases with back pay because of the outrageous nature of the way they're applying the policies. This was an attempt to take some more of the teeth out of that attendance policy. The other part of this, guys, for those of you that have followed the litigation we've been into over attendance policies, there are currently 6 court cases where our unions went to court and tried to block the application of an attendance policy. And the nation's courts have ruled these are minor disputes that have to be arbitrated, but every time we've gone to court, the railroads have said the same thing. They've said, we don't bargain on attendance. Well, guess what? They just did. We have cracked the door open on negotiated attendance. It may not be everything that the members wanted, but the door is open. And once it's opened, it's not going to be closed. When you couple the medical events without attendance points, and you couple the days off we've talked about without attendance points, unassigned service as we know it, or as we knew it, will be dramatically changed moving forward. And that was the attempt to address quality of life issues, guys. Access to predictable time off, many of you have it if you're an engineer on CSX or NS. On the BLET side, the Western roads don't have that. I know on the Smart TD side, on a lot of roads, they don't have that. But this gives us opportunity to go find that with the general chairman having leverage on the days off. The medical side letter also requires the general committee to meet and discuss the rules that will govern how you get access to this time off for medical events. And as Jeremy said, there was no national one-size-fits-all for any of these issues. These need to be addressed on a per-location basis, a per-general committee basis, and that's why the agreement was written the way it was.
So, the final step to what we had to cover when we got a tentative agreement done was questions and answers. And I hope you all got a chance to read them, but we set a record, 127 of them. You know, anybody that's ever looked at an airline pilot agreement, I think we got close to their record. They usually like to Q&A an agreement about to death. So was, you know, a process that took a little bit of extra time, especially with this many of them, because remember, these had to be agreed to with the carriers. So I hope you've all had a chance to get a good read on those, because there was a lot of clarifications. I hope it answered a lot of your questions and the rumor mill that was running rampant out there. But moving forward, the ballots are out. I hope everybody's got their ballot. And I know we've been getting a few phone calls for guys that didn't get theirs, so let us know. You know, we'll get one out as soon as we can. If you haven't got yours yet, you know, but what we're looking at here moving forward is let's get it ratified, get the back pay, and we can move on into serving our Section 6 notices for the next agreement. But if not, you know, that is the membership's decision. That vote, if it does fail, then we will be looking at going back to the cooling off period and having to go back to the table and readdressing any of the issues we can. Now, the other part, we're at, like I said earlier, we are at the end of the Railway Labor Act. After that PEB, that cooling off period, self-help, that's where it basically ends. So the other issue is now Congress. So if Congress wishes to intervene and step in and keep the nation's supply chain moving, that is a real possibility. And we would be looking at, you know, what are they going to adopt? Are they going to take something that looks like the Wicker-Burr bill and straight up adopt the PEB recommendation? And we would go back and have to start over with this process. Would they adopt a failed TA? Or would it be, you know, the mystery behind door three? God only knows what. So that is what we're looking at there, and I hope it gets ratified. I hope, you know, we can get moving forward, because I'm ready to get to work on the next agreement and keep this process moving for the next round of negotiations. But I'm sure you guys have some questions, you know.
I'm going to add a little bit here to this.
Oh, sure. I'm sorry.
Going back to next steps, guys. I think it's important for everybody to understand where all the other unions ended up. As we said before, 12 unions, first time ever, went united to a PEB. Since that recommendation came out, the TCU, Clerks and Carmen, ratified. The machinists rejected, they revoted, they ratified. Firemen and Oilers, Shopcraft, ratified. IBEW ratified. Smart Mechanical ratified. The remaining four unions that have not settled the round are the Smart TD, BLET, the Signalman, and the Maintenance of Way. All four of our unions, Smart TD obviously and BLET, are on the same cooling off cycle. It is the members' decision, as Jeremy said. Nobody's being told how to vote. We're just being informative to make sure you know what your options are. But as we said before, if we don't ratify, we go back to the government. That's what the Railway Labor Act will do. When it comes to what the options are, there are a lot of people out there trying to suggest that somehow your rights were taken away when we agreed to let you vote. And that is so far from true, it's unbelievable. None of your rights have been taken away. We came away with improvements to the PEB recommendation, and the wage teams of both unions decided that it was time for the membership to decide. Under the BLET internal law, a president can't refuse to abide by the wage team's decision. On top of that, on my union, only the general chairman can set a strike date. The general chairman voted to let the members vote on the agreement. So it's in front of you, and it should be properly in front of you, because we've reached that point in time. If you reject, we will return to the cooling off period. It will end on December the 8th. Our two unions have December the 8th as the end of our cooling off period in common. Maintenance of Way did not. Their cooling off period was originally going to end on the 19th of November while we were still counting ballots. Today, Maintenance of Way agreed to extend their cooling off period to match the Signalman's cooling off period date of December the 4th. That gives you guys time to make your decision with all the rights that you had in September. As we said before, it was very unlikely that you were going to get to hit the bricks in September. Congress was not inclined, and this isn't about political parties, guys. It wasn't about the midterms. That, too, is an urban legend. This was about Congress not being willing, I don't think from either political party, to allow us to impact the supply chain. It's too fragile. The question is, what will they do come December if we get to that point, because we do not ratify? As Jeremy said, that Congress can do any number of things. And the one thing I'm going to go back to is what they did in 1991, because I'm one of the few guys old enough to have been here for it. Crew consist was on the table, guys. And they got into it at the PEB, and that got imposed by Congress, and that's when we lost the brakeman on through freight. I was running an engine when it happened. We went conductor only because the Congress imposed a PEB recommendation that included a fast track on crew consist at the time. If Congress gets back into this, I'm not telling you what they're going to do, we're just telling you what they've done. In 91, they imposed the recommendation. Straight out recommendation, and it was bad. They created a second panel to hear disputes over what the hell they meant the first time. And all it did was delay the process. If you look at the BLET National Agreement from 1991, there's no signatures on it. Because we didn't vote it, we didn't sign it, Congress imposed it, they can. There are those out there telling you that Congress can't do that to you. They're wrong. Congress can, they call it an act of Congress for a reason. They have the right to settle this under a combined authority under the Railway Labor Act and the Commerce Act. And they've utilized it before. There are also third parties out there telling you you should defy Congress if they settle your contract. That's called a resignation. Some of these folks aren't actually trying to help you guys. There are people out there trying to cause, I think, confusion, to sow discord, to try to confuse the issue as to what your decisions are. Be real clear, guys. This is your decision to make. Our goal here tonight is to make sure you know what's on the table, what you know you would receive if you ratify, and what your options are if you do not. But if you do not, in all likelihood, we will approach the end of the cooling off period. You will have all the same rights in December that you had in September. They were never taken away. And if that means we have to go on strike, Jeremy and I'll be out there on the picket line with you. The question is, what will Congress do? They have rights to do things, and I'm not going to even predict what they might do, but trust me, they're watching. I think the maintenance away extending their cooling off period gives us more time to either get this deal ratified or return to the table. Maintenance away has made their return to the table tied to paid sick leave. The railroads have said no because we did not prevail on that issue at the PEB. So that is the battle that they're in going down to the end of their cooling off period on December 4th. So time will tell how this all unfolds, guys, but the eyes, I think, of the nation are on our membership right now. But I would like our membership to be left alone and be allowed to make their decisions without outside interference from third parties who don't give one rat's ass what happens to you. And you can tell them I said that. With that, would you like to open it up to any questions?
Hi, my name's Steve Salagi, local chairman in Cleveland, 792. Mr. Pierce, earlier you had said that SMART had essentially won the crew contest. I know General Committee 687 is still currently arbitrating that, working with them to handle that. So could I get an answer from Mr. Ferguson? Is crew contest done, or are we still involved with it?
No, what we mean by that is the carriers were attempting to put crew consists at the national level and put us into a expedited arbitration process. What that meant was whatever the TA or the PEB recommendation was imposed, whichever happened, that we would negotiate at the international level for 6 months, couldn't come to a conclusion, then we would be forced to go to arbitration. That would take away any bargaining power or any ratification process or anything that is going on at the general committee levels, because they were forced into negotiation / now mediation from those previous arbitration awards that we had 2 years ago. So what we're looking at here is they wanted it done in one fell swoop, kind of like Dennis alluded to there with PEB 219 in 1991, which I'm too young to remember. So just clarify that. Does that answer your question, brother?
I mean, just to make it clear, we're currently not done with it. It's still handling
correct
on the property. Can we make it clear to the membership that's all viewing and everybody else that this is not a dead issue? I know it's been said multiple times on Zoom meetings and everything else, and we're treating it as such. I feel like we're putting out false information to
give
people the impression that that's not a dead issue. I feel like the other thing as well with crew consist is people were getting the idea that it may have been part of the discussion, feeling like there were concessions made
to accept this portion of the contract as part of getting that some sort of protection from that. Was there any talk of that in amongst putting out this tentative agreement? Was any of that brought up with it or anything like that?
No, because crew consist was off the table at the national level. So there was no talk on that, because we have fought many a court battles that crew consist belongs at the local level. And by local level, I mean the general committee level. So by them losing that argument at the PEB, that issue was put to bed once again. Because crew consist, if they would have been successful, would have been, quote, a dead issue within probably 8 months from now if they would have succeeded. Because we wouldn't have been able to come to an agreement in 6 months, forced to arbitration, the arbitrator would make the decision, and the conductors could have been removed from the train following that arbitrator's decision, and it would have been over. That's it. So this is a separate issue that is at the general committee level for certain general committees that have moratoriums that were opened up. Other general committees, like mine, for instance, doesn't have a moratorium that's open. So there is no negotiating going on. There is no mediation going on. They're not forced into that process. But yes,
And I didn't mean to mislead with my comments, guys. The point I was trying to make, it goes back to being at PEB, around during PEB 219. The PEB panel pushed this thing to conclusion very rapidly. They tried again this time. This wasn't a new move. They tried to recreate PEB 219 at PEB 250, and they failed. That is a huge victory. I never meant to allude to the fact that the issue is not still in play in mediation on certain railroads. But I think it's also worth noting, and not just stepping into to Smart TD's world here, but NS, BNSF, and UP are the three that remain at the table in mediation. The record in mediation is 9 years. Amtrak was there. They didn't get released. The railroads wanted binding arbitration. If this was even to get a release through the normal channels where it's now stuck at the RLA, each one of those railroads could end up at its own presidential emergency board for a non-binding recommendation as compared to being pushed immediately fast-tracked to binding arbitration. So I still call it a huge victory, and I think it is, and I think those of us, myself included, that have conductor seniority view it that way.
Patrick Redman, Division 607, BLET. Can you guys elaborate a little bit in terms if the contract is, or the tentative agreement is voted down? The process in which we go through the cooling down period until December 8th, and does Congress have the capability of blocking a self-help by either the unions or the carriers, and the time frame from the blockade to when they actually settle an agreement through a congressional act, the timeline that could be, and in the terms of my understanding, during that time, let's just say it takes a month, the carriers have the ability to implement their own wages on us and work rules in a sense that we're working without a contract until Congress acts. Is that true?
Let me take that.
Yes.
Good question. Obviously, the cooling off period, if it ends December the 8th, would be the point where both parties reach the right to self-help. And to the part of your question about what those rights are, we would have the right to strike. We would have, and this is if Congress stays out of it, we would have the right to strike, slowdown, property by property job action. All of those things you've always wanted to do would become available. At the same time, the railroad has the right to lock you out. The railroad has the right to promulgate the rules. They did it to the conductors, the UTU conductors in 1971, I believe. They paid them minimum wage. This is the one point in time, guys, where it can be argued that your contract technically could be considered expired because they have the right to modify it once we get to that point. So don't ever view this as a one-sided thing where we can just strike them and they can't touch us. In 72, they promulgated the rules, changed the pay rules to get the unions to strike, to blame it on them, to make Congress intercede. In 1991, when we got to self-help after PEB 219, nobody voted that agreement. Neither of these two unions did. When we got to the end of the cooling off period, it was viewed that it would be a sporadic job action program. The machinists walked on CSX. The railroads promptly locked us all out to make Congress take an interest and motivate. I think 17 hours later, Congress passed a law. So it won't take them long to pass a law. We've distributed to our bargaining units the copy of the law Congress passed in 91. And here's the other part of it, guys. The panel was appointed by a Republican president. The Democrats controlled the House and the Senate. The PEB recommendation, when it was put on the floor of the Senate, passed 96-4. Same problem then that we have now, fragile supply chain. So the idea that Congress won't act or won't act swiftly, the question is, if your goal is to strike, and I understand that. We've got a lot of anger out there, guys. You've got every right to be pissed off. Between precision scheduled railroading attendance policies and the way these assholes have treated you, you have every right to be angry. What we're trying to ask you to do is put the anger aside long enough to look at what your options are, because this will go before Congress eventually. The longest strike in my time was, I think, in 82, it was 4 days. We got 17 hours in 91. There's not been a federal job action, national job action by the rail union since then. But Congress is paying attention, and I think they're poised to take action. The Burr-Wicker resolution that Jeremy referenced could be resurrected. They could try to push that through. They could impose the recommendation without the upgrades that we've negotiated. They could give you the TA we negotiated. For those that want us to go back to the table and reopen attendance or reopen quality of life issues or sick leave, the railroads have a list they'd like to reopen. At the top of it is crew consist. And Congress can do that too. This isn't a scare tactic, guy. This is just you make the decision. If you can tell me what the hell Congress is going to do on anything, I'll take your advice because I don't know. We have a dysfunctional Congress, and the elections that took place yesterday, I don't think made that any clearer that they're any more capable of settling your agreement for you in a way that you like. So we've already been accused tonight on social media of trying to force you by threatening you or scaring you as to what Congress will do. I'm not doing that. If you got any idea what Congress will do, you make your own decisions. But the idea that they will let us shut down the nation's economy for any length of time, I don't think is likely. It wasn't in September. But if we get to December, we'll find out. And I promised I wasn't going to swear tonight.
I got to get some swear words in, though.
Tom Dillon, legislative rep from Local 278 Jackson in Detroit, Michigan. I got a couple questions for you. First one, Mr. Pierce, I got, you said in the TA, the BLET outlines that the NS can't serve notice on the ABS. Now, how does that one and done apply to the BLE when regarding with the auto bid system, being that they already have it?
Yeah, good question. Side letter five was an attempt while we were at the bargaining table to identify the railroads that have already accomplished what they wanted to from both sides. Though the questions and answers that are in side letter five were agreed upon by the general chairman and by the specific railroad. For example, Norfolk Southern. Norfolk Southern already has automated bid. In other words, they don't have a displacement time when they get bumped. They read their bid sheet, they go to that job. They may not work it that day, and I know bump time became precious with attendance policies. But at the same time, on the railroads where they already had that in place, they waived the right to ever come after it. So on NS, they will never have the right for the engineers to come after either any change to the current automated bid system or to implement any self-supporting pools, because they've already got them where they want them. Labor on the same side for the BLET agreed we're not going to pursue any notice on days off, because the jobs we wanted to get days off for, that was accomplished in the 2015 on property agreement on Norfolk Southern. CSX is similarly situated. Canadian National is similarly situated for the BLET. The primary railroads that have never adopted a lot of this for the BLET are the Union Pacific and the BNSF. But even they've limited their rights as to how far they will go when it comes to pool regulation and things like that. Side letter five is very important as to how it limits people's rights to even use these articles that are causing a lot of the concern over the agreement.
So in a sense, their one and done's already done.
Yes.
All right. The other thing I got is with the wage increases with the projected retro pay. It's relatively would be simple math to figure out, but I've heard from other people that I know from different crafts that have already settled, and they adamantly admit that their numbers were way off. They got less than what they thought. Now, obviously, I don't know what their finances are, but would you say that those are hard facts?
Are calculators available that will tell you based on your wages. There's a couple of things for operating employees to remember, though, when they calculate that. When trip rates were created, there's a certain portion of the money in every trip rate, in most cases, that was frozen. The ITD, FTD, those kind of payments that were rolled in, they were frozen in 85. They stayed frozen when they were put in and distributed to everyone. In application, they take the trip rate, they roll out the frozen, they apply the increase to the increasable portion, and then they put the frozen back in. So on any given trip rate, if you're working a through freight job on certain railroads where that is still true, the wage increase might apply to 99% of your wages, might apply to 98, depending on the run you make and how much ITD and FTD were in it. But those are approximations based on that earning level going forward based on what you made in the years. It's different for every year. I mean, some of the confusion could be that in one year you might have made 80, you might have made 90, and there's 3 years involved in the back pay period. So the calculators that have been created, I think, allow you to put in your annual number for each of the years involved, and it gives you an approximate number. These aren't guaranteed numbers. They're all approximations. But it's pretty close.
And Tom, do I have the mic? I want to refer you also to Q&A number 16. That does detail specifically that anybody on the class ones that has a dispute, put it in writing within 30 days, goes to the general chairman, you get a detailed breakdown of how your back pay was calculated. All the other carriers that are not class ones that may be involved that are watching this, they too can go through that process, but that is just how the commitment came out in this particular Q&A, but we do have that protection built in if anybody wants to dispute how their back pay was calculated specifically.
That's good. The last thing I got is if, let's say Congress does have a voice in our future, what are the odds of them being able to drastically change anything that has anything to do with our RRB or time that we have to work on property to collect or retire and anything of that nature? Is that anything? It's been said on various social media sites along with other misinformation, but is that an option for them to enact any changes to any of our retirement plans?
The Railroad Retirement Act is a law, and it was a law written by Congress. So Congress has the right to change any law. The debate is whether it's likely they would interject a change to that law as part of settling our contract. We've not heard of that other than, as you say, the misinformation out there in social media. I think you can believe about 4% of what you see on Facebook. But again, that's not really been part of what we've been discussing with either the railroads or even when we were on the Hill that Congress was inclined to do anything like that. I think the when you analyze where Congress sits right now, it's unclear as to who will have a majority next year. But the December 8th deadline will land in the hands of what you would call a lame duck Congress. And the question is, will they even be there? We're pretty clear they weren't going to let you strike in September. I don't know what they're going to do. They may be more dysfunctional in December than they were in September. And if your goal was to see street time, it might happen. I don't know how quickly they'll react. I don't know what they'll do when they do. That's why we're just trying to share with you the rights they have, not really a prediction of what they'll do. But again, Marty Walsh took a hit last week because he came out and said he expected Congress to intervene. That's fairly consistent with what we told everyone when we decided to let you vote in September, that we thought they would intervene. So it really didn't come as a big shock to us. But again, if Congress does intervene, they'll have a lot of options in front of them. And who controls Congress? One of the options Congress has, guys, is to punt this by extending the cooling off period to the next Congress just to walk away from it. They could do that. If Maintenance Away hadn't extended their cooling off period on the 19th, they could have punted them to December 8th to match us. So Congress can basically do whatever it sees fit to do. When it comes to whether Congress is labor friendly or not, the Democrats only own 50 seats even under the lame duck structure and don't have the 60 votes they need to pass anything. Right now, the Republicans have made it clear in the Senate, at least they did in September, they would never allow anything to pass that exceeded the PEB recommendation. So those are the things we do know. What they'll actually do, that's kind of why we're just laying it out for you guys. If anybody's got a crystal ball on what this Congress is going to do, I'm all ears.
Chris Emery, 378, Cleveland Collinwood. I have a healthcare question with the rebidding of the system. Is that going to happen every year? And also, is that going to change like the coverage map area? As an example, I recently moved very short distance from my house to a new house. I fell out of the current coverage area I had, and I still see the same doctors and everything, but now I changed plans to like the out-of-network plan, which costs more. Is that also going to be looked at in the rebidding process?
Jeff, would you like to take a... Jeff Brandow, Smart TD, is here. He's probably better qualified to answer this than we are.
Yeah, thank you. And thanks for the question, Chris. The rebid process, as far as frequency goes, the parties have agreed that it's going to happen whenever the contracts with the healthcare companies expire. They come up for renewal just like any other contract we have with anyone else that we do business with. Typically, it's between a 3 and a 5 year period for these different, we refer to them as vendors, the different healthcare companies that the plan does business with and has contracts with. There is the possibility for disruption that you talk about, Chris, where if we're talking about a medical network, where it could be, you know, where you in practice, what it would be is that you the doctor that you have now that's in network could end up being, you can still go see that doctor, but they might be considered out of network. To stay in network, you might have to go to another doctor. With that being said, and we shored this up in the Q&As as well, there's always been an understanding through this process when we've done it in the past. The most recently we did it was in 2017. We bid the pharmacy benefit manager as a part of the 2017 agreement. But there's always been the understanding when we go through this rebid process, and there is now, and again, we reaffirm this in the Q&As, but the understanding is that whenever we do that and whenever a decision is made to change vendors and go to a different insurance company for whatever that service is, that we do everything that we can to limit that sort of disruption. And also, we do everything that we can to make sure that if you end up in another network, that that other network is at or about the same size, because we know what the railroads will do without asking them, is that they would, if it was entirely up to them, they would look at it purely monetarily and just say, throw them in the cheapest network. We don't care if they've got two doctors in a 50-mile radius. That's it. Deal with it. That won't happen under this. And I'm confident in saying that too, because even if it goes to the highest level of dispute that we can within our healthcare plan, there is so much precedent set about minimizing that sort of disruption. So I can't tell you that it won't happen, but if it does, it's going to be very minimal. And I think more importantly than that, and you know, we talk about all the rumors and stuff that we see on social media and whatnot, the most important thing about this rebid process is that it's not going to change your level of benefits. Your co-pays, your deductibles, your out-of-pocket maximums, the monthly cost share, the definition of what is and isn't covered, none of that changes through this rebid process. It just basically says that you might be dealing with a different insurance company to get those same benefits, but your benefits will not change through this rebid process. Does that pretty well cover it, or?
I think it does.
Okay.
Is Chris good? All right.
Thanks, Jeff.
Sorry to throw you in a hot seat there, Jeff. You're good at it.
Guys, just add one thing about the rebid process, if I could. The principal officers of all the unions serve as joint plan holders through the CRLO and Smart TD, or through the UTU plan. We have two obligations. One is to bargain, and that would be our settler role. We have a fiduciary role also to make sure that the plan administers fair benefits without impact, like you're talking about. And that's why we've avoided the disruption of say, moving from two networks at your location to one, which would make it more likely you could fall out of in-network and pay more by being out of network. So we're very cognizant of what we're going to be doing here. The goal will be to keep the plan costs down, because your 15% could rise. This year, I think the premium went up 8%, roughly, was what the rate setting reflected by last year's experience. In 2020, it was lower than that because everybody was locked at home and the only people went to the doctor are the ones that had COVID. But the other benefits were put to the side, and so the plan cost didn't go up because it wasn't used as much. So utilization drives cost, what you pay when you go drives cost, and then what the discounts are with the doctors through the network and then the vendor part of that are the moving parts that we plan to utilize to try to keep your 15% as low as possible without diminishing your benefit set.
This rebid thing, just to emphasize that, this rebid process does, I thought it was interesting, the carrier's arguments to PEB 250, and PEB 250 agreed with it, that if there's a 15% cost-sharing contribution from the employees, that it's going to cause the unions and the union members to take a more active role and more of an interest in controlling costs of the healthcare plan. And as much as I hate to admit it, occasionally the carriers are right about that, and they were in this case. There's a 15% cost sharing contribution. We're going to take a better interest in that. Now we're going to have disagreements about how we achieve those savings in the healthcare plan, and that'll be fun to explore. But this rebid process presents a huge opportunity for us to do that. Again, we can provide the same exact benefit to our members, and if we can bid them at a lower cost, and get those same services at the same quality at a lower cost to the healthcare plan. You know, we see these numbers up here on the projector right now, and that trend is with all the entire time that through this trend, when that cost was fixed, the unions, we didn't pay that much attention to what the overall cost of the plan was, because we know the railroads can afford it, right? So why are we going to concern ourselves too much with that cost? If our out-of-pocket every month, if our cost-sharing contribution is fixed, we're not too worried about what the railroads are paying for it. But now there's opportunity in this rebid process that will benefit our members. It creates a lot of work for us as the unions. You know, bidding out one of those contractors is quite an undertaking, but if it's going to save us and our members on monthly cost-sharing contributions, that's a good investment. And I think that there is good opportunity in this process. It's something that the carriers wanted, something we would rather have not had to deal with, but there is opportunity here, and it will create savings.
And I think side letter three gets overlooked a little bit too, about some of the secondary benefits that provides for the unassigned through freight guys, including extra boards. Dennis talked a little bit about the person that was charged under the attendance policy for having a heart attack, but we were adamant that our members that are in through freight service had to get some time off so they could go to the doctors to get preventative care. Now, granted, these mark-offs, these three occurrences that you would be entitled to under this side letter, is not paid, but it is free from the attendance policy, and we hope everybody's going to take advantage of that and go get, you know, preventative exams. They do include going to the eye doctor, to the dentist, but, you know, get the heart checked, get the colonoscopy, get your blood checked for sugar, get your sleep apnea checked, whatever the case may be, because the biggest benefit to that is it may just save your life. I've lost three friends out here on the railroad to colon cancer between, you know, the ages of 38 and 45. They knew they had it in their family. They didn't mark off, so forth. They were too busy working, and they didn't want to get in trouble, blah, blah, blah. We get it. But guys, this is an opportunity to get some preventative medicine so you can be around to enjoy that retirement we work so hard for. Now, one of the other effects to that is, obviously when you look at plan cost, if you go get a colonoscopy and we catch cancer at a very early stage, that's going to save the plan a heck of a lot more money than if they catch it when you have big problems and you're at stage four. I don't want to lose anybody else out here, but, you know, if we all take advantage of going and getting that preventative care from the excellent healthcare plan that we have, the dividends are two and threefold from what we have opened the door on as far as it comes to being able to go do this kind of stuff without attendance policy issues. So I'll quit repeating myself.
One other add-on, guys, over the 15% premium payment. As with the last four contracts, and I think that's important to remember, all four of those contracts ratified by the members, and we agreed to pay 15% of the premium. Obviously, it was a lower number then because the premium number was lower. The plan costs went up, the 15% goes up, it's just math. From day one in 07, when this started, the unions also negotiated that your cost would be pulled out through a Section 125 portal. In other words, it's taken pre-tax. When you pay your point of service cost, had they gone up, your copay, your deductible, your annual maximum, that comes out of your taxed income. The premium payment comes out of your pre-tax money, much like 401k money. To pay the 309 that it's going to be, you'd have probably had to have 400 gross to have a take home to pay 309. That's the benefit of paying this pre-tax. And that's been in place all four times we've agreed to the 15% to diminish the impact out of your take home pay. So that is carried over into this agreement as well.
Nick Papo, Vice Local Chairman 792 of the Smart TD over here in Cleveland. This question is kind of for both of you guys up there. So the biggest, one of the biggest things going into this agreement or contract was the quality of life, as we all know. I mean, it's been the biggest thing everybody's been talking about, but, you know, all the members throughout the United States, railroaders, you know, wanted to see. That's what everybody's eyes were peeled for. You know, I hear members from both unions, a lot of members, saying that the ball was dropped, unfortunately, because, you know, no one really sees, you know, because, and the reason why, again, this is for you guys, because I know you guys were at the table, and we look to you for the answers, you know, for all of us and everybody else that's watching and whatnot, but in your opinion, where do you see the quality of life was corrected for everybody? Because the three occurrences that you talk about, that mainly deals with health, okay, and the attendance policy. But I think the ball was dropped when there was no paid extra holidays off, or the sick days was huge. And so you take that away, and we didn't get none of that. You know, we're back to the same railroad. And you guys know we're getting beat down pretty bad. You know, not just anybody in this room, but, you know, the guys in the West Coast, everybody, you know, with the PSR. I've been, you know, around long enough to see a lot of changes. And I'm very fortunate, you know, with my seniority that I'm able to work a yard job with 2 days off, thankfully. You know, I've been out here going on almost 27 years to get that, though. But that doesn't take away from all the guys that are on the road and all the other guys that are in the yard where, you know, just as putting as many hours as we're putting in over the last couple of years, and to see no extra paid holidays or no paid sick days, you know, we feel like, you know, just the ball was dropped. And the one day, unfortunately, you know, the one day that we got is kind of like a slap in the face, unfortunately. So I just, if you guys could address how you guys view that, and just, you know, it's just an honest question.
Well, thanks, Nick.
Sure.
You know, first thing I want to say is I've heard you say a few times the ball was dropped. The ball was never dropped. These unions, us too, never backed down. We never gave up ground. We never gave an inch through this whole process. Like I said, you don't go to the PEB and negotiate. You go and litigate. So unfortunately, if anybody dropped the ball, and I don't take exception to the way you asked the question, don't take me wrong, but when you go to the PEB and you make your arguments and they don't come back and rule in your favor, that unfortunately is what we have to basically live with. But we still didn't back down after we got those recommendations, and we went back to get everything else that we could possibly get to the last few minutes, right? So we got to keep pushing. Now, when we talk about the paid sick days, that was us that brought that forward in our Section 6 notices, and we stuck with that argument the whole way through. And we're not done. We're looking at, you know, executive orders, other issues that are out there to be able to get the possibility of paid sick days outside of contractual negotiations for everybody that's out here in service. So we're not done, and I promise you it'll be coming back around again. Now, you know, sidestepping just a little bit, you know, yeah, we were ready to strike. Heck, I wanted to strike as a new president, right? That would have been a great thing to have on my resume, right? First time in how many years that we had a national strike. But I do want to compliment each and every member and family member that supported that movement that we had going in September. It wasn't just Bernie Sanders. It was each and every one of you guys and your family members that wrote in, called in to your congressmen and to your senators. The negative publicity that we brought on these railroads isn't going away. If we would have just came quietly in the night and put up a picket line and said we're on strike, the media and everybody else would have just probably said, yeah, that's more union guys wanting more pay. We weren't raising hell down there in D.C. about more pay. Yeah, we'll take it anytime we can get it, right? But ultimately, we were raising hell about the quality of life. And people couldn't believe we had guys that only got 1 day a month off, that didn't have rest days, didn't have a scheduled weekend, anything like that, that didn't have paid sick days. So we're not done. It's unfortunate it's not in this one, but I don't want anybody walking away from here tonight thinking that either of these two unions backed up or gave in or anything to that effect, because we never backed down. And if the only ones that gave anything up in those last 3 days and that last stretch there in September were the carriers. You read the recommendation, you read what's in the TEA. We're the ones that got the additional. They didn't get anything additional from what the PEB recommendation was. So We're with you, brother, and we're going to keep fighting.
Yeah, I agree. You know, like I said, dropping the bomb, maybe that might not have been the best.
No, no. Hey.
I used to stand up talking on the microphone, but it was just, you know, quality of life, you know, you hear it every day, so.
Well, you ought to come up here. I don't like cameras. I got this fear of cameras, so.
if I could add to that, guys, and I'm failing at checking my vulgarity.
Shit, I forgot to swear.
You forgot to swear. There is no contract that we will ever put in front of you that will make your employer stop being assholes. They're going to still be assholes. They were assholes 45 years ago when I went to work for them. They haven't changed that much. They've changed their stripes. They've changed the name of the program. But they're the employer, and we're the union out here fighting to make it a better place to work. Our goals by getting the days off, you guys know the incentives they've got to offer to hire right now. They have poisoned these jobs nationwide. Where I hired out in Lincoln, Nebraska, it used to be people standing in line. They're offering $20,000 to get people to go to work because the word's out. You don't want to work for these people. That impacts the supply chain. To Jeremy's point, we have brought that. You have brought that through your efforts with Congress. You have helped us bring that to the attention of the United States government and the population. That's why they're scared to death of a job action right now, because they know how strong you guys are and how critical you are to the supply chain. We will never stop fighting. We will never get it all done in one fell swoop. But to Jeremy's point, we are going to be back at the table in 2 years. Whether this is resolved by you ratifying or by Congress or by a strike and a capitulation by the railroads, whatever the possibilities are, we'll be back at the table in November of 2024. And all of these issues are going to be back on our wish list to go back and revisit. In the meantime, we're going to do everything we can in the regulatory front, the legislative front, with the administration, to try to get changes to how you guys are treated in the workplace. So the fight's not over. I don't think it'll ever be. There's always going to be work to do to improve the jobs. But I am convinced, guys, that access to this time off without points on the railroads where they get points for taking unpaid time today is going to dramatically change the lifestyle of those jobs. I think it is an improvement to that quality of life issue. But it's really up to the members to decide if that's sufficient. And we will respect the vote either way, guys. There's the third parties will tell you we're going to do this, that, or the other thing, depending on how you vote. If you vote no, you vote no. A couple of urban legends will dismiss. A non-vote is not a yes vote. It's a non-vote. We count the ones that show up. We're not accepting binding arbitration if you vote no. We will run the cooling off period down to the end and then take action as we see fit. All of our bargaining unit folks will be brought into that loop internally for the BLET. It takes the general chairman to set a strike date. And they'll be asked to do that if we get to that point. We've never been afraid to strike. We've never been trying to avoid a strike like some of these third parties want to tell you. We're trying to get the contract settled. And at a certain point, I think some folks have to take a step back and do you really want just to poke them in the eye with a strike, or do you want a new contract? Because they're not actually the same agenda on any given day. There is money in the deal. You guys are long overdue for a wage increase. Working for 3 years without a wage increase is unconscionable. We've got to do something to address the wages. There is money in the deal. To the argument that it may not be enough with the cost of living, when contracts are done on time, they're always done prospectively, and you don't know what inflation will be in the out years. It's never been a one-for-one equation in a contract. 7% is the wage increase this year. And it will come close to what the annual inflation was. In 2020, inflation was 1.9, there's 3% in the deal. I only share that because it's never been a one-for-one with inflation. But to the guys that say I'm voting no, it's not enough money, it's more than the zero you get if you vote no. We've got to get a wage increase to our membership, guys. That was critical as to why we pushed to get released from the mediation process and get this thing in front of a PEB if necessary to try to get something for you guys to consider. So right now the ball is in the membership's court, so to speak, and we want them all to vote. We'd love to have 100% turnout. I think it'd be great if everybody participated and we knew crystal clear where to go next.
Teddy Potts, Local 586. CSX, we have a lot of conductors who are saying that the biz system's going to be shoved down their throat. You have the opportunity here. Could you please express how this will work as an on-property agreement and what could come from this that we're just not getting it shoved?
Well, Ted, I don't know could you clarify a little bit what you mean by shoving it down your throat? Because it is a reality. It's going to happen. But like I said, it's got to be negotiated by general committee. So that is going to run its process. and if they can't agree or you guys don't ratify what they agree to as a tentative agreement, then the arbitrator will decide. So that could be where that's coming from. I'm not sure, but this is a reality. It's not going away. So
I understand what you're saying there. A lot of misconceptions about there, especially on social media, that there will be no negotiation with it, that it'll just, this is what you get. How do you go? But with that being said, in the PEB, I believe it says that there will be negotiations and 180 days, correct, to negotiate that and talk about it and everything else?
Yeah, and it Article 6 clearly says negotiate, not impose, not shove it down your throat, but actual negotiation. And if your general chairman, which is my general chairman, right, because I'm from your committee, probably, so if he can't agree with what CSX is proposing, then that arbitrator will look at all the facts, and I'm sure they will be well documented knowing our general chairman. And if he can show that CSX is not negotiating, but they're trying to impose something, well, then they're in violation of our national agreement. So I'm sure that arbitrator will rule accordingly. So
one additional comment, guys. Side letter 5 is critical to the application of Articles 5, 6, and 7. It specifically states that because we can serve notice for rest days, they can serve notice for ABS self-supporting pools, they can all be combined if the parties wish and be handled as one document. For the engineers on NS, Mark Wallace is with us here. He was a general chairman in 2015 when they adopted what they do. They accepted automated bid. They have self-supporting pools. They have 6s and 2s at a lot of locations as a default. And what the self-supporting pool accomplished for those guys is, in some cases, it sped up the work during the 6 to where they could afford to take the 2 scheduled, knowing when they were, without any loss of earnings. So there are ways this can be managed when you complement each side's pieces with the other to where it can all be done as one document. It can then be presented back to the membership and be considered at the local level as to whether or not that accomplishes the goals of 5, 6, and 7. But side letter 5 is critical as to how those things will interplay with each other.
Nick Griffith, Local 278. So my question relates to, I understand the self-sustaining pools, you know, the voluntary off days, but relating to the ABS, was it the intent during the negotiations for to obtain those secondary benefits, as you guys spoke on, for like the craft of conductors? So is that a possibility? There's a lot of misinformation, as we spoke on out there, that they just get ABS, the carriers, if they serve notice. But is the intent to get additional secondary benefits for the conductor craft through the general committee negotiating? Is that what is going on there?
Absolutely. I mean, it is negotiations, quid pro quo, you know, the back and forth. What are they going to trade for us to agree? You know, that whole process. And to quote your railroad, the Norfolk Southern, who testified at the PEB, I mean, this has a dollar value of about $38 million a year to accomplish this, right? So, I mean, some of that excess money obviously should flow back to the membership. But no, nothing like Ted asked, it says you're just getting it, period. It has to be negotiated and or arbitrated.
I just wanted to clear that up to make sure that we're getting the additional benefits if that does come on the table.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Patrick Redmond, 607. Kind of go off the brother's question. A lot of these notices, Article 5, 6, 7, is that the hopes, at least from, you know, your guys' positions, that a lot of GCAs are able to put together a full on-property agreement, something similar to what BLE, NS, Northern, and NS has done, you know, to coincide with the conductors or on CSX? Is that kind of your hopes with that, or did it just kind of fall into play with how the PEB recommendations and, you know, said everything's, not everything, but most things are more on property based negotiations than national, and for the UTU or SMART is the crew consist. I believe the PEB said that's not a national issue, that's a on property, which would then force everything back to the GCAs. Is that correct?
I think it's a good start. Go back to the days off proposal, guys, Article 5. That was our idea. That was based on what the feedback was we got, both unions, from our general committees, through their local chairman, through the membership. You've got to get us access to days off when we don't have them. We made that proposal. The proposal we made to the PEB was accepted by the PEB. It is cut and paste in this document. Every word of what's in the agreement language is part of the proposal we made, both on property and at the PEB, that the railroads rejected from day one. They fought us tooth and nail at the PEB. They said there's no reason these guys need days off. Again, they're the assholes in the room. Gotcha again. Full circle to 6 and 7. Those were their ideas. That's what they wanted where they didn't have it. And NS made the presentation that we already have it, we don't need it, but here's how we do it. CSX already has it. On automated bid, BNSF has it, everything except the displacement time. That's the only part they're going to change because they've got a system-wide process. But this does allow a system-wide negotiated process to take place if that's what the general chairman sees fit to do. I got to tell you guys, as Jeremy said earlier, there was no one-size-fits-all at the national level. We're representing memberships on 7 or 8 different railroads. The operations don't match. Hell, your operations don't even match terminal to terminal. A 6 and 2 might fit in Cleveland. It might be a 7 and 3 in Buffalo. I mean, it's that simple that we don't have a tool that imposes something on you guys at the national level because it's not going to fit. So it was our intent to push this, as Pat said, back to the general committees and give them leverage. The BNSF guys will tell you that in the UP, where they don't have rest days at all for engineers, they have been trying to get them, but they had no leverage. They had no bargaining power because the railroads would give them a pilot. It costs money. They cancel it. As Jeremy said, these are once and done agreements. Once rest days are put in place, they can only be modified under the Railway Labor Act by serving a Section 6. They're permanent. We will permanently change unassigned service where you don't have rest days today to give you access to predictable time off. The bulk of our attendance cases don't occur at guys on a 5-day yard engine because they know when they have the time off. That's the world we're trying to bring to unassigned through freight. But it does lend itself to the opportunity to make it a system-wide settlement, much like the engineers have on NS and CSX.
Hello. John Esterly, BLET Division 34 in Columbus. I've gotten a question kind of throughout the state, and I'd wonder if you two would address it. For those of us that are either BLET members working as conductor or SMART-TD members working as engineer, can you speak to how an agreement would be implemented if one union would ratify and the other wouldn't, particularly when it comes to back pay? How would that be calculated? Or if there's an engineer that's a bubble that kind of bounces back and forth, how would those numbers be calculated?
Good question.
I'll take a shot at that one.
It's 2 days.
We are in interesting times, guys. This is the second time in all my years at the railroad, which are many, he'll tease me for my age again, that both sides of the cab have voted on the same agreement at the same time. That was our goal. We first did this last time in the 17 agreement. Our two unions had never bargained together prior to that in the history of the two unions, not nationally. That was quite an accomplishment. Jeremy's predecessor, John Prevasech, was the guy who agreed that our two unions had to put down the swords and work together because we all have this common interest in the cab. And last time around, both sides voted at the same time and both ratified. That doesn't mean it will happen this time. We have to be prepared for every eventuality. As John said, BLET could pass, SMART-TD could fail, or vice versa. And the union that settles will determine how you're treated for the time you worked under that contract in the retroactive period. So you may have to, if one side settles and the other one doesn't, you may get part of your back pay if you were between the two crafts and have to wait for the other part. One union could ratify, the other could be imposed. One could have a different agreement imposed than the one that was ratified. When you get the cube out, the Rubik's Cube, and start looking about all these possible eventualities, it's a long list of possible outcomes that we have to be prepared for. I can't tell you. Guys, when we look at this on a scale, and we look at the last contract from the BLET perspective, 12.5 over 5 years, 15% cost sharing, increases in co-pays and deductibles and out-of-pocket maximums. Passed by 85%. Come full circle, 22%, plus $5,000, 15%, no change in your out-of-pocket cost. I don't know if it's going to pass. And here's why. People are pissed off. That's the reason. PSR, attendance policies, just the shit you guys have to put up with every day, that's why it might fail. And we're not telling it, so we've qualified this, we've taken criticism for it. We need to wrap up the round. We got to get a wage increase in you guys' pockets. We've got to get the negotiations wrapped up, and contracts do have a way of working out. But we can't tell you for sure how this will all unfold in the coming weeks. We can tell you for sure that you have about 10 more days to cast your vote. I think the 20th at midnight will be the end of the count period. We're both using electronic voting procedures, which gives you down to the wire. That's why we think there's value in this video going out to make sure everybody understands what their options are. When we get up that Monday morning on the 21st, the majority of those that took the time to vote will decide the issue. And that's democracy. It really is. And the more that participate, the more democracy that is in my mind. So the goal is to get as many people as possible to cast their vote, hopefully understanding what their options are. But what will happen on the 21st, if you want to get out to Vegas and start talking to the odds makers, they probably have a better idea than I do.
3-1. 3-1, Matt? Which way?
Any other questions, guys?
It's one more. I just wondered if we had utilized any of the, earlier you mentioned that the political action committees or the lobbyists had got to the Hill to have our voice heard when it came time to see how they would view or allow us to proceed. Have we gone back to the same committees or lobbyists to see if things do not ratify where we stand? Or are we utilizing them to get a little bit of an idea for a reassurance for our members to say, hey, you know, don't be afraid to vote what you think is in your best interest. Don't vote out of fear, but vote what needs to happen to move in a progressive fashion.
You can take it for granted. I mean, it's a true story that people in Congress are reaching out to us. We don't actually have to get 100 people on the Hill right now because all eyes are on this event, guys, because this is critical to the nation's supply chain. There are cities in September that did not have chlorine to treat their drinking water that comes by tank car. There were power plants that were short of coal. Those were kind of the decisions that I think Congress looked at the time, and they would look at them again. So they're very interested to know how we think it's going to turn out, and unfortunately we've had to tell them we don't know. They are paying attention, and they will take their action based on what they do. But make sure that you understand, to Jeremy's point earlier, we're not letting up on this. The world now has attention to the fact that these railroads have been treating their employees like shit. And that we're not going to take the heat off of that. We're going to keep that flame up. We're going to keep going after them for these issues, whether it's the STB, Surface Transportation Board. Jeremy testified there. Mark Wallace testified there. If there's anybody getting abused more than you, it's the customers. We actually told them when it came down to strike talk that a 24-hour job action, a strike, would probably improve customer service. It's so shitty. At least the customer wouldn't have to look out the window and wonder if his car was not coming that day. He would know. So I don't mean to be flippant, guys, but we have made every argument to every person that will listen in Washington, D.C. We continue to make those arguments. Both of our legislative teams have been very active. Any other questions?
Jeremy still hasn't passed.
Well, guys, I do want to thank you all for coming. It's nice to see you. I know you don't get that much time off. It's nice to see you come join us and talk about this. Again, our goal is just to make sure everybody knows what their options are. Please get out there and vote. Please get all your coworkers to vote. We've timed this to be both unions doing the same thing at the same time to give you that opportunity to be able to talk about this in the workplace. Don't get any fistfights. We recommend you don't do that over it. I know there are passions on both sides. But our goal is to get as much participation as we can.
And please, you know, get the word out there so everybody's voting with the facts, right? We're always chasing down rumors and lies and half-truths. That's why we hold these meetings. We've done everything we can do to make sure we get the truth out there to dispel all those bad things. So I want to thank you guys for coming. It's a pleasure to be here with you.
Thanks for being here, guys.